Good morning and welcome to your math video. Today we're going to discuss the topic of elasticities and their application in business and economics. So, what is elasticity? Elasticity refers to the degree of responsiveness in supply or demand in relation to changes in price. If a curve is more elastic, then small changes in price will cause large changes in quantity consumed. If a curve is less elastic, then it will take large changes in price to effect a change in quantity consumed. Why is it used? Elasticity is important because it's used to determine how changes in price affect the quantity demanded by consumers. Understanding this relationship helps us to determine whether a price should be increased or decreased.
We can distinguish three types of elasticity of demand: price elasticity of demand, income elasticity of demand, and cross elasticity of demand. The price elasticity of demand is a measure of how much the quantity demanded of a product changes when there is a change in the price of the product. The formula used to find the price elasticity of demand is the percentage of the variation of the quantity demanded divided by the percentage of the variation of the price. The income elasticity of demand measures the sensitivity of demand to change in income. The formula used to find it is the percentage of the variation of the quantity demanded divided by the percentage of the variation of the income. And the gross elasticity of demand measures the sensitivity of the quantity demanded of good A measures to a change in price of good B. And the formula used is the percentage of the variation of the quantity demanded of good A divided by the percentage of the variation of the quantity demanded of good B.
So, in order to explain the price of elasticity of supply, well, we can define it as basically a way to measure the responsiveness of the quantity supply in a change in price. So, this can be represented with the following function, which means the percentage of the change in the quantity of supply divided by the percentage of the change in the price. So, this, contrary to the PED, is considered as upward sloping, and that can be represented in the following graph.
Total cost is approximated by the rate of change of the total cost function evaluated at the appropriate point. For this reason, economists have defined the marginal cost function to be the derivative of the corresponding total cost function. In other words, marginal is a synonym to the derivative of. So here we have the revenue, both the average revenue and the marginal revenue, which was the one that we just explained. The average revenue, we just take the total revenue and divide it by the quantity of units produced, and we have the average revenue. And the marginal cost and the marginal revenue, as I already explained, what we have to do is find the change of the total revenue divided by the change in quantity, and we find the derivative total revenue. In cost, we have the same thing. We have the average cost and we have the marginal cost. In the average cost, we just divide the total cost by the quantity of units produced. However, in the marginal cost, we have the change of the total cost divided by change in quantities, where we have the derivative of the total change in cost. So, as an example of marginal cost, we have this. A division of dinner industries manufactures a Butier model microwave oven. The daily cost in dollars of producing this microwave oven is the following cost function, where X stands for the number of units produced. So, as I mentioned before, we know that the marginal cost is actually the derivative of that cost function, where one unit extra is produced, one additional unit. So it's the difference of the total cost and one additional unit. So, what is the marginal cost when X is 100, 200, and 300? First, we have to find the derivative of the cost function, which is this. After finding the derivative of the cost function, we simply plug in the values, and we have here the answers of the 100, 200, and 300, which will be in 100, 114, in 200, 120, and in 300, 138.
Here we have an example of marginal revenue. Our management of Acrosign plans to sell a new speaker. So the demand function is price equals this. The price P represents the speaker unit price in dollars and X quantity demanded. So the revenue function is price times X, which is this, and we multiply the demand functions by X. To solve marginal revenue, we have to do the derivative of the revenue function, which is this. If we want to know how much revenue they make by selling 5,000 units, we plug 5,000 in the marginal revenue and we get 400.
Alright, so now I'm going to explain the value of the price elasticity demand. So, there are five types of elasticity that we can find inside the price elasticity demand. First, we're going to start with when a function is perfectly elastic. So, the value of the price elasticity demand is infinite. So, the percentage in the change of the quantity demand is always going to be infinite. Moving on to the next one, we're going to talk about the elastic ones. So, in the elastic one, the value of the PED is going to be superior to 1. So, therefore, the percentage in the change of the quantity demand has to be larger than the percentage of the change in the price. Elaborating on that, I'm going to explain the unit elastic. So, in this one, the value of the PED has to be equal to 1, in the sense that the percentage of the change in the quantity demand has to be logically equal to the percentage of the change in the price. Last but not least, I'm going to explain the inelastic demand. So, in the inelastic demand, the value of the PED has to be inferior to 1. So, as I've already explained, the percentage of the change in the quantity of demand has to be smaller than the percentage of the change in the price. Finally, in the perfectly inelastic way, the value of the PED has to be equal to 0. So, in this case, the quantity of demand does not react in price. Right, so everything that has been previously explained on the table can be then represented in a graph. So, the basic principle we have to take out of all of this is that the more horizontal the function is, the more elastic it becomes, and vice versa. The more vertical the function is, the more inelastic it becomes. I'm going to explain this with two basic examples. So, in elastic functions, we can see that basically they should, in theory, be closer to the horizontal axis, which can be represented in this way. On the other hand, in inelastic functions, they should be closer to the vertical axis, which can be represented with this line. And that's basically it.
So, in this example, we're going to see the profit function, the marginal profit function, and as well how the difference of the units, if more units or less units, affect your price. So, if the total cost in dollars incurred in manufacturing X electrostat speaker systems in the first year of production will be the following cost function. This is the following revenue function as well. So the profit function, you know, would be the revenue minus the cost. So here we plug in the revenue function minus the cost function, and we will get this function. So B, the marginal profit function. So as we already said numerous times, marginal is synonym of derivative. So the marginal profit function will be the derivative of the profit function, meaning it will be this. Moving on to this side, where we're going to compute the different units into the marginal profit function, we have 5,000 and 8,000. If we plug in 5,000 units into the marginal profit function, we'll get $250. If we plug in 8,000 in the marginal profit function, we'll actually get $10. So this is to say that when you begin to produce more, in this case, when we plug in 8,000 units, you actually gain less. So maybe it's not the best business plan.